Good morning. It's good to have you here as we gather online to receive the gifts of God. And we gather in the name that was pronounced over us at our baptisms. We gather in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. This is the fifth Sunday in the season of Easter, and it's also Mother's Day. So, typically, when we are gathered together here, we have flowers for all the women of the congregation, including the moms. And we can't do that, of course, but I am holding a rose in your honor. And we certainly remember you on this 2020 Mother's Day. So, let's begin our service. Lesson for this fifth Sunday in the season of Easter is John chapter 14, verses 1 through 14. Let's read that right now. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also, and you know the way to where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you so long, and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, Show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me, or else believe on account of the works themselves. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Wouldn't you love to have heard the conversation at the Last Supper, Jesus' last meal with his closest followers before his death on a cross? Well, you're in luck. we have a transcript of the conversation that night. In fact, that's what we just read from John 14, part of the conversation from the Last Supper. So what kind of people were those disciples of Jesus? We might imagine them to be different than we are. Maybe we expect them to be people of superior faith, or expect them to have a better grasp of who Jesus is and why he came. But they didn't. Not at that point, anyway. Nor did it appear that they understood the strange words of Jesus. Words like, "I go to prepare a place for you." Why was all that so difficult to understand? Because the disciples were aghast at the idea that Jesus would die the next day. They just couldn't comprehend it. That's why Thomas insisted that they didn't know where Jesus was going or how to get there themselves. They expected Jesus to stay and be crowned the earthly king of Israel. But Jesus came to die as an atoning sacrifice. He was the sinless Son of God, the personification of God. As Jesus told Philip, "If you've seen me, you've seen God the Father." It's hard to grasp, but God came down to die for us and redeem us. All of us human beings, the apostles and us too, impose our own desires, our own aspirations, our own ideas of what is best and how things should be. We impose our own ideas rather than accepting God's ideas of what's best and how things should be. Things like death, or physical illness, or mental illness, or poverty, or struggle, or failure. We don't include any of those things on our list of how things should be. Nor should they be included on that list. They're not good. So it's hard for us to understand how what is painful in God's hands could miraculously turn out to be the source of something positive. It's hard to understand how what is deeply disappointing or tragic for us in God's hands could ultimately produce what is best. But that's what we're promised by God. And that's what happened in the days following the crucifixion of Jesus. The tragedy of the crucifixion turned into the glory of the resurrection. And these disciples of Jesus, who appear so faithless and weak and cowardly here in John 14, they reshaped the entire world with a message to sinners of all people, an announcement of forgiveness and reconciliation with God. For sinners, grossly imperfect people like us. And in this process of proclaiming the gospel of God's forgiveness and mercy for sinners, these formerly faithless, weak, and cowardly disciples were found to be courageous. In fact, all but one was killed in the process of proclaiming the gospel. These men suffered. Which brings up this very difficult passage, John 14, verse 13, which says, "Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified by the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it." Jesus was talking about prayer. That's an enticing promise. Whatever you ask, whatever you pray for, I will do. Whatever you ask in the name of Jesus. He was promising his closest original disciples, the apostles, that all their prayers would be answered. And yet, most of these apostles were killed for their faith. I'm guessing that's not what they prayed for. I certainly hope that in your life you've had some prayers answered that were absolutely miraculous and wonderful. It's happened to me, and it's happened to a number of you, I know. But certainly not all my prayers have been answered. Certainly not as I've asked, nor have yours. In fact, Some of us have prayed that God would spare a loved one, that God would take away your pain, that God would provide something we desperately want, but God didn't. That's why this is a difficult verse, and it seems like the critical phrase is, "Whatever you ask in my name." So what does it mean to pray in the name of Jesus? Well, for one thing, it means to pray that His will be done, just like the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done. That's not easy. We want our kingdom, not God's. And often our will is not God's will. So praying in Jesus' name might mean praying that you would love someone you hate, or praying that you might be filled with humility when you're pumped up with pride. It might mean praying to accept tragic loss or death or pain or bitter disappointment. It's not easy to pray that God's will be done rather than our will. It's not an easy thing to pray in the name of Jesus. There's fear involved. What's going to happen? You know, the bottom line is, we're afraid to trust God. You know, 1 John 4:18 says, "Perfect love casts out fear." The Greek word used there for perfect is the root word used in John 19, when Jesus was quoted while dying on the cross and said, "It is finished." The Greek words for perfect and finished come from the same root. The idea being, perfect love is completed love, finished love. And if you want to see what that looks like, you look to the cross. Perfect love casts out all fear. But that perfect love isn't your love. It's the love Jesus has for you. The perfect one is Christ. So even though your prayers are imperfect and your motives self-centered, Jesus' love for you is perfect. It's complete love that never fails. Jesus died on a cross for you, not because you're filled with faith and eager to do what He asks of you, but because you so often fail at doing what God asks of you. Jesus died for us who are sinful. He died not for the righteous, but for us who see the truth of our own unrighteousness. He died not for us who are innocent, but for us who are guilty. He died for us who call ourselves believers, but wrestle with doubt. He died for us who are weary and worn and sick of our own sin, but we continue to sin. He died for us who are often unlovable, and He yet loves us and gives us hope that does not fail us, hope that comes from God's forgiveness and acceptance, bought and paid for by the blood of Jesus shed on the cross. How do we know all that? Because though He died, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
My soul.
Let's take a few minutes here to pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your great love and compassion and mercy for us. Help us to respond to your great love for us by helping us to love you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love each other and all our neighbors as ourselves. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Heavenly Father, we pray for our world. And we ask that you would bring peace to our world, particularly in those areas where there is outright warfare, in the Middle East and in parts of Southeast Asia. Lord, please bring peace to this world. Lord, we also ask that you be with the leaders of this world, the leaders of the different countries, including the United States of America. Lord, we ask that you bless all the nations of the world with justice as well as peace, and that you lead and guide all the leaders of the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, I also pray for the congregation of Christ the Vine and ask that as they pray to you in Jesus' name, that you would hear them and see them and respond to them in ways that they would recognize your presence and your love and your compassion for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, we also pray today in particular for Jerome Windland, who is hospitalized, having heart surgery this past week. Lord, we ask that you heal and strengthen Jerome, that you also be with his family, be with his mom, Lorraine, particularly, and comfort her and give her peace regarding Jerome's condition. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, we also pray for Lloyd Davis in Walla Walla, Jerry's dad. Lord, please be with Lloyd and strengthen him and heal him as he deals with heart issues. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, we also pray for Sharon Sikirka, Jean's sister. Lord, please be with Sharon. She has been diagnosed with cancer. Lord, please be with her. If it be your will, we ask that you would heal her. In any case, Lord, please comfort her and give her confidence of your presence with her. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, we also pray for my sister Marta. We thank you that she is home and ask that you be with her as she recovers from her long hospitalization and her coronavirus encounter. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, we also pray for Ted Lutz, who is hospitalized at least the last couple days. Lord, please be with Ted. Be with Sandy, his primary caretaker, and comfort and strengthen both of them. Lord, we pray for Ken Peterson and Donna. We ask that you be with Ken and Donna, who is in need of prayer also. Lord, we pray for Kurt Bumkrot. We ask that you continue to bless him with good health. And Lord, please be with Jennifer, his wife. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, we also pray for Tatum Lutz, a little four-year-old girl diagnosed with cancer. Lord, please pour your mercy and your healing down upon Tatum and her family. Lord, we also pray for Harry Griffin, a five-year-old boy, also diagnosed with stage four cancer. Lord, please be with little Harry. And again, we ask that you pour your mercy down upon Harry and his family. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, we pray for all those throughout our country and the world who have been afflicted with the coronavirus disease and all diseases. Lord, we pray for those who are sick. Lord, we pray for families who have lost loved ones. And Lord, we thank you and pray for the medical professionals who are working night and day to attend to those who are sick. And Lord, we thank you and pray for Lynn Clapp, one of many nurses in Portland, and also Lynn and Steve's daughter, who's on the East Coast, Shannon, working with COVID-19 patients. Lord, we ask that you keep her safe and strengthen her. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, we thank you for your great love and your great compassion for us. And we conclude our prayers by praying the words that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I mentioned that today is Mother's Day, and so before we leave this morning, we would like to pray for all mothers everywhere, a special prayer for mothers on Mother's Day. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your great gift of mothers. And Lord, all of us have a mother. Some of us may not know our mother, but all of us have mothers. And Lord, there is not an institution invented by you or mankind more important and more significant and more impactful than the institution of motherhood. And Lord, we thank you, all of us who have had mothers, we thank you for our mothers, for all the work that they have done and all the critical influence that they have given to each one of us. So Lord, on this Mother's Day, we thank you for those who are blessed to be mothers, and we thank you for for all of us who have had good and wonderful mothers. And we thank you for them, for our mothers, on this Mother's Day 2020. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. And the very last thing that I have to say is this: the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Go in peace. And remember, you're baptized. Christ is risen.
Just reading our Bibles.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. It's the last couple weeks we said we're going to read our Bibles, and now we are.
Yeah, so what book are you reading?
We just told you. The Bible.
Well, I know it's the Bible, but what book in the Bible? Because you see, the Bible's made up of many books, like Genesis and Psalms. You can see the name at the top of the page.
Oh.
The name of the book.
Oh, yeah. The name of the book is John 14.
Okay.
Wow. People had numbers in their names back then. Were they like robots or something?
Or maybe they were 14 Johns and he was named last.
No, the 14 is really the chapter. Like as in chapter 14.
Oh yeah.
That makes sense.
Mm-hmm. I see the section is called Jesus Comforts His Disciples.
Yeah. But I was actually having a hard time understanding the part that they called Jesus is the way to the Father. Well, what's that all about?
Okay. Well, you see, at this point in the Bible, Jesus is telling his disciples that he's going to have to go away.
Oh, well, I bet they're sad.
Yeah, they're sad, but he tells them not to worry, that he will prepare a place for them. And they ask him, where is he going? And he says, you know the way to the place that I'm going.
Yeah, I see that. I just see that they're like, we don't know which way to go.
Right. He says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
Yeah, I find that confusing. I mean, Jesus is a person, not a street.
Yeah,
well, let me give you an example. Let's say you're lost in a forest.
Why would we be lost in the forest?
I don't know. It doesn't really matter. It's...
Oh, I bet we were kidnapped.
Oh, yeah. Kidnapped? Why would we be kidnapped?
Because we are the world's greatest secret agents.
Oh, yeah. Wait, how would we have gotten kidnapped if we are the world's best secret agents?
It doesn't really matter why you're out in the forest, but let's just say that...
Oh, I got a good idea. Mrs. Jordy, what if we're looking for some treasure and got lost?
All right, the treasure should be right around here somewhere.
Splash?
Yes, Dean?
Is that a map? Or is that a picture of Winnie the Pooh as a pirate?
Oh, man.
Okay, yes. Let's say you were outside looking for lost treasure. And let's say that there were many paths that you could take home.
Yep, there's a lot of paths.
So how would you find your way home?
I'd probably use the GPS on my phone.
Right.
It always tells me where to go.
Yeah, right. That works. You know, in life, Jesus is our GPS. If we follow him, he will show us the way.
Where will he lead us?
Down the right path. You know, to everlasting life.
Oh, wow. Thank you, Mrs. Georgie. This makes a lot more sense now.
Yeah, thank you.
I know the Bible can be a little confusing at times, but never be afraid to ask, okay? And I guess I'll let you get back to your reading.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Hey, you know, I really want to go look for buried treasure now.
Oh, okay, but I'm going to have the map. Yeah, well,
it really doesn't.
Crap.
Do it again. Yeah, wait. How would we be have that kidnapped?
Yeah.
In the mind pillow. The name is John 14. Wow, there's a lawnmower going by again.
Also, the line is, yeah. You see, the Bible's made for many books.
Oh, yeah. Wait, there's a lawnmower again.
The lawnmower guy's back.
He is.
Maybe we need to kidnap him.
Yeah, I'm not ready to.